today we are going to finish our study here of Isaac and Jacob, and we're going to be in chapter 35 of the book of Genesis. This chapter is a transitional chapter. In other words, we're kind of finishing up the story of Isaac and Jacob and setting the stage for the next phase of Genesis, which is really speaking more about Jacob's son, specifically focusing in on his 11th son, and that is Joseph. And so we'll get to Joseph this next spring, so mid-January, for those who are watching online. We'll be starting our study on the life of Joseph, and we will finish the book of Genesis. And so by the time we finish next spring, it'll be 4 years in Genesis. Really, really cool. Anybody here been here for the whole time so far? Oh, we have to give prizes by the end of next semester for those who were here for the entire thing. That is pretty awesome. Not that we don't value those of you who have joined us in the later part of the study of Genesis. I've loved Genesis. It's the first time we actually did anything this in-depth. Usually we take a book and do the whole thing in 10 weeks in one session. 1 year we did the entire Old Testament in 2 semesters. Yeah, we were doing 1 to 2 books a week. And that was lots of fun. Almost put me in the grave. I thought I'm going to wait a while before doing that again. But it was lots of fun. That is archived if you ever want to go. And, you know, in like 27 weeks, I think it was like 27 teachings, we went through the entire Old Testament. So that was a while back, but it was lots of fun. But this is the first time we've really slowed down to this extent. But it's been okay, hasn't it? Because, it's been broken up into more topical kinds of things. Genesis does lend itself really well to that. So it's been lots of fun. But today, Genesis 35, the transitional chapter, kind of wrapping up some things with Isaac and Jacob and getting prepared to look at the life of Joseph, which will happen in January. We'll be there. So let's pray, and then we're going to dive in. Lord, we just thank you for the absolute joy it has been to look at the lives of Isaac and Jacob and just all the wealth that is in your word that just speaks to our hearts and encourages us and blesses us as we see they're just people like we are and they go through stuff just like we do, and yet you are faithful. That's the big picture we see. We thank you, Lord, for choosing us. We did not deserve it, but we just give you great glory and honor and gratitude for choosing us and saving us through Jesus Christ our Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so as I said, Genesis 35, a transitional chapter. It kind of finishes up, in a sense, the story of Isaac and Jacob, and then it transitions into the next phase of Genesis, which will be the life of Joseph. So starting in Genesis chapter 35, verse 1, God says to Jacob, "Arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there. Make an altar there to the God who appeared to you when you fled from your brother Esau." Now, this is the fourth time that God reveals himself to Jacob. And the first time God had revealed himself to Jacob, it was at Bethel when Jacob was fleeing his brother and he was headed all the way north, 450 some odd miles, to find a wife there of his mother's relatives there in Haran. And he did find a wife. In fact, not just one, but he has 4 wives. That wasn't his intent, but that's just kind of how things worked out. And so now he's back in the land. He's come back in the land. He is at near Shechem, but some really awful stuff has happened there at Shechem. His daughter Dinah was raped. Two of his sons, Simeon and Levi, they are the full brothers of Dinah. She was their little sister. They went in and killed all the men of Shechem. And then all the women and children, the rest of the brothers, came along and they plundered the city and they brought all the women and children as captives. And so now Jacob's, the people he's responsible for, has increased dramatically. He has all these Shechemites that are his captives, in a sense. And he now is responsible to care for them. And Jacob, it ended last time with Jacob rebuking his sons, going, you know, you've made a stink to everybody in the land. This is the land God is giving us. And now the people hate us and they're gonna attack us. And Jacob may be possibly feeling very much a failure for not being able to, you know, lead his family in such a way that his, you know, his sons wouldn't have done this horrible thing that they have done. And now in fear for not only his own life, but his family and all the people he's responsible for and all the possessions, all of this, you know, God comes to Jacob. And I'm sure Jacob had been crying out to God. And God speaks to Jacob and says, okay, it's time to get up and go to Bethel. That is the place where I met with you. That is where you saw the ladder from earth to heaven and the angels of God going ascending and descending and God, myself, you know, standing there, so to speak. God says, I met you there when you were terrified before. This is the place you need to go. Besides, after, you know, Jacob had that dream 20 years before, or more, actually, more at this point, Jacob had said, this is an awesome place. This is the house of God. And he actually named it Beth-El, which means house of God. And Jacob made a vow at that time when he had left the land that if God would bring him back safely and be with him and, you know, fulfill his promises, that Jacob would come back to Beth-El and he would build an altar and he would establish a place of worship there at Beth-El. So God speaks to him now, another terrified Jacob, much later in his life. And God says, you need to go back to Beth-El. Get up. Go up to Bethel. And it really was up. Bethel was only about 15 miles away from where Jacob was in Shechem, but it was 1,000 feet higher in elevation. It was along the major route that Jacob probably took during these years that he was at Shechem, heading south to go all the way down to where his father Isaac was living. I mean, scripture doesn't say that Jacob visited Isaac, but we're going to see an indication that possibly he did during this time that he was at Shechem. So he would have passed by Bethel on his way to visit his father Isaac. It's 15 miles away, 1,000 feet up, but Jacob had never moved there. Now God says, I want you to move there. I want you to fulfill your vow. I want you to worship me, and I want you to build, to live there. So, you know, Jacob gets his whole family together and all the people that have joined with him, i.e. the Shechemites, and he gives them instructions and tells them that God has spoken to him and they are now going to Bethel. God tells Jacob, I want you to build an altar. Now, although it was the practice of the patriarchs to build altars, we've seen that with Abraham and Isaac and even Jacob, this is the one and only time God actually commanded one of the patriarchs to build an altar. So God tells Jacob, I want you to build an altar, establish a place of worship, move to Bethel. So verse 2, Jacob says to his household and to all who were with him, so his family and everyone else who are with him now, put away the foreign gods that are among you and purify yourselves and change your garments. Then let us arise and go up to Bethel, literally up, we're going up 1,000 feet higher, go up to Bethel so that I may make there an altar to the God who answers me in the day of my distress. That's why I'm saying Jacob was probably calling out to God and he was distressed again because of what had happened at Shechem. So here is the God who answers him in the day of his distress and has been with me wherever I have gone. Verse 4, so they gave to Jacob all the foreign gods that they had and the rings that were in their ears. Jacob hid them under the terebinth tree that was near Shechem. By the way, that's that same tree that Abraham notes, that when we studied Abraham, he notes that there was this tree near Shechem. So Jacob leads his family now in a time of consecration and purification before they go to worship God, the true and living God. And Jacob, first of all, tells him, you've got to get rid of all these foreign gods that you have. Now, whether Jacob knew at this point that his wife Rachel had taken her father's household gods or not, it's time for Rachel to bring forth these gods. as well as the people of Shechem and all the plunder and loot they'd taken. They'd probably gotten a whole lot of idols, a bunch of foreign gods in Shechem. So these are distributed among the people, whether it was Jacob's own household or it's just the people that are with him, there are foreign gods. And, you know, Jacob knows God well enough to know that God does not tolerate any other gods. And if we're going to come and worship God and establish worship of the true and living God here in the land, we have to put away these foreign gods. And so they do. They also take out their, they also are commanded to give the earrings. And what is that about? Well, they have discovered a lot of these idols, you know, thousands of them that have been discovered in the Middle East. And a lot of them are decorated with jewelry. So they'll have earrings or a nose ring or even a necklace or something that they discover with them. So it could be the earrings that were with the gods. It's like, don't keep a piece of it for yourself because, you know, that's valuable. I can wear that. No, everything that is associated with that foreign god. Or it could also mean they themselves had earrings. Hosea speaks of this. And he speaks of how when the children of Israel would worship false gods, that they would dress themselves up and get really fancy. And he speaks of, Hosea speaks of putting on this special jewelry. Very hard word, right? To put this on when they are going to worship these false gods. And so, you know, maybe it was that. It could be either. It could be the earrings that the false gods had decorating the idols, or it could be the earrings, you know, the special, you know, I deck myself out to go worship when I'm worshiping this false god. By contrast, we don't have to deck ourselves out to worship the true and living God. In fact, what God requires is a purity of life. That's what God wants. And so that's why he says you have to purify yourselves. Not only are we going to get rid of this stuff, and by burying it under the tree, they're not like, oh, we'll come back and dig it back up because we know where it's at. No, they're burying it because it's dead. It's dead. So they're giving it a funeral. We're done with this. So they bury it. And it's just noted where they buried. So not only do they have to cleanse their lives spiritually from these gods that they've been relying on, kind of like their backup plan to the true and living God, but they also are to wash themselves and to change their clothing. What's that all about? It's that idea of just purifying your life. You know, when you worship God, it's not some casual thing. It's intentional. And, you know, we don't today, you know, have to go through all these rituals that they are necessarily going through at this time. That was just a physical, picture of spiritually. And the psalmist picks that up and says, who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, speaking of going up to the temple to worship God? He says, he who has clean hands and a pure heart. In other words, our heart is right in our lives, what we do, our actions, those are right before God. And if they're not, it's not some big process. You just go to the Lord and you confess your sins and say, Lord, here I am and I'm dirty and I'm a mess. I mean, later on, the minor prophets will speak of Joshua the priest, and he's dressed in filthy garments, and he can't minister because he's just, it's filthy. And so what do they do for Joshua? They clean him, and they give him new garments. And that's speaking of just that cleansing of life and being right with God when you come to worship him. Don't just run in for worship with God with your life all a big mess. If it's a mess, take it to God and then come to him with a clean heart and clean hands. And so Jacob, we see this even with the patriarchs, before all the law and the Jewish stuff and the customs, we see that with the ancestors, with the patriarchs, that cleanse your life, get things right, and come and worship God. And don't stay away, deal with it. Ask God to cleanse you and then come to him. So Jacob is, you know, saying, let's commit ourselves to worship. Let's obey what God has said. We're going to purify our lives. We're going to get rid of these idolatrous things. And we're going to go and worship God. So verse 5 says, and as they journeyed, here's the answer to Jacob's prayer. A terror from God fell upon the cities that were around them, so they did not pursue the sons of Jacob. The very thing Jacob was afraid of, that they would be attacked, God was taking care of that for him. Maybe up to this point he thought, well, God takes care of me because, you know, I'm following him. But maybe there at Shechem, it's like, I don't know if God's going to take care of me now because we've really blown it. I mean, my goodness, his sons committed genocide. His daughter was raped. It was horrible. It was awful what's happened. They plundered the city and took all the people's stuff and the women and the children. And, you know, he was probably feeling really awful and thinking, well, maybe God won't fulfill his promises because I'm such a mess and my family's so bad. We're just so bad. And yet God shows his great grace. God doesn't just bless and take care of us when our lives are together and we're following him and everything is good. God still keeps his promises, and it's not based on our faithfulness. The scripture says we are faithless. He remains faithful. God keeps his promises, and it has nothing to do with us. It's because he's made the promise, and he keeps his word. Now, that doesn't give us license to go out there and live an awful life, but it is a great comfort when we mess up, isn't it? That God will be faithful, and he will keep his promises, and its faithfulness is not dependent on our faithfulness. It's dependent on him. He is faithful. It's who he is, and he keeps his word, and when he's made a promise, he will keep his promises. So God protects Jacob, even though they don't deserve it. This is grace again. Old Testament, full of grace all over the place. And Jacob came to Luz. That was the name of the little Canaanite city. That is Bethel. That's what he had called it when he had been there, you know, 30 some years before, which is in the land of Canaan, he and all the people who were with him. And there he built an altar and called the place El Bethel. So he adds, you know, a little bit to the name. This time he had already called it Bethel, but now he is doing it in the presence of all the people who are with him. And he says, this is now El Bethel, meaning God, the God of Bethel, the house of God. God, the God of the house of God. Because there God had revealed himself to him when he fled from his brother. So God protects them. God brings them there safely. And Jacob keeps his vow. He builds that altar. He establishes Bethel, or now El Bethel, as the place of worship. And he stays there. And then verse 8, the next thing that happens while they're there, it says, and Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, died, and she was buried under an oak below Bethel. So he called its name Alon Bakuth. Okay, Deborah. Who is Deborah? Her name has not been mentioned ever in Genesis. Who is this person? Okay, it says right here that she's Rebekah's nurse. Who's Rebekah? Jacob's? No, that was Rachel. His mother. Rebekah's, I get those mixed up all the time too, so don't feel bad. Like, Rachel, Rebekah, who was who? You know, it's easy to get them mixed up. So, Rebekah is Jacob's mother. How in the world is Jacob's mother's nurse with Jacob? All we know is when Rebekah had, you know, years and years and years before, when she had left Haran and her brother Laban and had come with Abraham's servant to marry Isaac, that she had brought her nurse. But when this is mentioned in Genesis 24:59-61, it just says, and her nurse. And then that there were other servants and other women with her as well, other servants that she had. So she didn't just come by herself. She did have her nurse, and she had servants, other women that served her that came with her when she came to marry Isaac. And so Jacob, when he's born, he knows his mom's nurse, Deborah. And she was probably to him like either an aunt or a second mom, because she had taken care of his mom and had served his mom. She would serve him as he was growing up. And so, you know, he didn't leave until, you know, he was quite a bit older when he left. And so he'd known her for lots of years. She was very, very close to him. And we see the indication that she might be close to him because he names the place where they bury her Alon Bakuth, which means the oak of weeping. So he's commemorating his sorrow at her death. How in the world did she get with him? She didn't leave with him when he went up to Haran. Well, this is one of the indications that, you know, people think, okay, he's visited his father. And his mother must have passed away because there's no longer any mention of her, just her nurse, and her nurse is with Jacob. So probably on one of those times that he visited his father when he was back in the land, because he's been there at least 10, 15 years or so. One of the times he visited his father before his father dies, his mother must have died by that point, and his mother's nurse, Deborah, came with him and joined him. So she's been a part of his company. We didn't know that until her death. And so here she is with them, and she's very, very precious. And you see how somebody who might seem to be like this unimportant side person, you know, whose name wasn't even mentioned until she dies. I mean, we know that she's been around, but, you know, nothing has ever been said of her other than her relationship to Jacob's mom. And yet, her name is now in Scripture. The time that she dies, when that occurs in, you know, the whole patriarchal story, and a special attention given to her that she must have been so important to Jacob because he commemorates her death and commemorates it by speaking of his grief at her death, the oak of mourning. And, you know, one of the things that just strikes out to me, you know, of all the things God could have recorded in the Bible, that this is recorded. And everything's important. And why is this in the Bible when so many other, I mean, his mother's death isn't even mentioned when it happens or anything about it. But hers is. And she's just this kind of, in a sense, unimportant side person that doesn't really contribute to the flow of the narrative, the story, the big picture that Moses is, you know, putting together as the Lord inspires him to write this book, the book of Genesis. So why is she mentioned? I think she's mentioned because God says he cares about everybody and that everybody is important. Even if your life doesn't have some big splash in the scheme of God's thing of what he's doing, even if you're just kind of like off to the side, kind of the behind-the-scenes kind of person, you matter to God, and he notes you. Scripture says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his beloved. God loved Deborah, and so God mentions her name. Not that he didn't love other people, but I think it just really highlights again how much God cares about every person, not just the big heroes, not just the people God uses in awesome ways, but God cares about every person. And the death of anyone that the Lord loves is precious to God, and he notes it. So, you know, that I think that's the thing that we can see here with Deborah. So she was with Jacob because Jacob's mom had died. She was important to Jacob, but she was important to God even more. Importantly, she was important to God. So her name is in Scripture and her death is recorded. So now verse 9, God appears to Jacob again. So this is the fifth time that God is revealing himself to Jacob. God reminds him of, you know, when he spoke to Jacob and changed his name after that night of wrestling, that all night of wrestling, that his name is Jacob, but it's Israel. God gives him this new name, Israel, which means Prince with God. And I think this in itself is another encouragement and affirmation for Jacob. You know, Jacob, yeah, you've acted a little like Jacob, deceiver, heel catcher, again. You haven't been the leader of your family you should have been. Idolatry's been going on. Your sons have gotten out of control. Not that we can control our adult sons, but in a patriarchal tribal society, there would be a lot more control over those sons, and he wasn't exercising that. And so he felt like a failure, but God comes to him again here after he's built this altar and he's worshiping, and God speaks to him and says, remember who you are. You're not a failure. You are Prince with God. You are Israel. You know, God reminds us over and over because we forget, because we mess up, and we forget who we really are. And we start identifying ourselves by our failures again, and God reminds us, that's not how I see you. I don't see you as you are in this moment in your mess. I see you as you are going to be because of my work in you. And so he looks at Jacob and he says, you're Israel. Remember, you're a prince with God. You know, we can't act like God's children. We can't act like a kingdom of priests and kings to God. We can't act like that if we're still identifying ourselves by our failures. And God wants us to remember who you are. You're a daughter of the king. You're royalty. You're a priest. Everybody in the church, we're called kings and priests. Priests minister to God. They minister to God. You're called to minister to God. That's who you are. You're his beloved. You are royalty. And we have to be reminded of this over and over again. Because we leave this place and we go and we yell at our kids or we do something stupid and we forget who we are. And then we start looking at ourselves as our present condition instead of who we are in Christ and who we will become. Amen. So the reality of how I act right now is not who I am. But the more I think about who I really am, the better my reality right now will be. Because when you're a daughter of the king and you remember I'm a princess, you're going to act like a princess instead of acting like somebody else that you really aren't. So God affirms his name again. Jacob, remember who you are. You're a prince with God. You're Israel. And then God affirms and renews the covenant again. The covenant he'd given to Abraham and to Isaac. And he'd given it to Jacob. And now he affirms it again to Jacob there at Bethel, that place where God first spoke it to Jacob. And so verse 11 says, God said to him, I am God Almighty. Jacob, you are Israel, and I am God Almighty. That word is El Shaddai, El Shaddai. And Shaddai, the root of Shaddai, is the word for breast. Now, this is not to be pornographic, but you think of the breast, the woman's breast that is meant to give life to the baby, to give nourishment, to sustain, to help the baby grow. And God is saying, I'm the one who gives you life. I'm the one who nourishes you. I'm the one who causes you to grow. I am El Shaddai, El Shaddai, God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. And he said this to Jacob, and Jacob has done this, and his fruitful and multiply is just about done. He's going to have one more son. But this is also being spoken to Jacob for his descendants as well, that his 12 sons, right now it's 11, there will be another one, that his 12 sons will become the patriarchs of the 12 tribes of Israel, and they are to be fruitful and to multiply. And God is just showing, I am faithful too. I mean, your father Isaac had 2 sons, and I chose you. But you're going to have 12 sons, and I'm not going to just choose one of them. I'm choosing all of them. and I'm going to make a company of nations from you. Going on. It says, a nation and a company of nations shall come from you, and kings shall come from your own body. The land that I gave to Abraham and Isaac, I will give to you, and I will give the land to your offspring after you. Notice God expands this. He said before, I'll give the land to you and your offspring. But here he affirms it. I'll give the land to you. I'll give the land to your offspring after you. Meaning all 12 of his sons, all of his descendants would be possessors of the land that God had originally promised to Abraham. So it's not just one son of Jacob's line, it's going to be all of his sons will become the tribes of Israel. So I'll give the land to your offspring after you. Then God went up from him in the place where he'd spoken with him. And Jacob set up a pillar in the place where he'd spoken with him, a pillar of stone. Remember when God spoke to him there first time, Jacob took the stone that he'd been laying on and set it up as a pillar. Now he does the same thing again. He sets up a stone as a pillar, and he poured out a drink offering on it and poured oil on it. The first time, many years before, he just poured oil on it and consecrated and called the place Bethel, house of God. This time, he pours oil, but he pours a drink offering. First instance of drink offering. This is predating, you know, the time of Moses and the law. But the drink offering was generally wine that was poured on to the altar for the sacrifice. It was symbolic of joy. It was symbolic of gratitude and thanksgiving. It wasn't a sin offering. It was a thank offering. More of like thank you God kind of offering. It wasn't an offering that forgave your sins. It was an offering of just blessing God. And that's what worship does, isn't it? It just blesses God. And so he pours out this drink offering. The Apostle Paul will use this idea later when he's talking about his impending death. And he says, he talks about how his life is being poured out as a drink offering, that same idea. And, you know, you get the picture of you're pouring the wine on the altar and the sacrifice, you know, has been made and it's hot. And when that wine, that liquid wine hits the hot altar, what happens to it? It becomes like a gas and it ascends to God. And so Paul is saying, my life is being poured out like a drink offering. And in the spirit now, I'm ascending to God. It's that picture. But it's our whole life is this drink offering. So the idea is my life being poured out in gratitude to God. That's what we are called to be. That, you know, what I do doesn't save me. That's the sacrifice. But my life is poured out like a drink offering, saying thank you to God. And someday my life will literally be poured out and I will ascend in the spirit to God. And just that final chance of saying thank you now for all of eternity in the presence of God. It's just such a beautiful, beautiful thing. So he pours out the drink offering. Then God goes up and Jacob calls the name of the place where God had spoken with him, Bethel. So God Almighty, El Shaddai, the one who nourishes, sustains, provides, gives you life, causes you to grow. You're not only going to be, you know, like the stars of heaven, Jacob. You're not only going to have many nations, like I said to Abraham, that there would be many nations. And from Abraham, there was not only the Jewish nation that came forth, but you have Ishmaelites, the nation of the Ishmaelites. From Isaac, there was not only the Jews that came forth through Jacob, you also had the Edomites through Esau. So we had the multiplicity of nations, but this is the only place and the only time God ever says to a patriarch, a company of nations, because he's speaking of the 12 tribes as if each tribe is a sovereign independence, but they're put together as one nation, one people. A company of nations. Another way to think of it is like the United States. The states are sovereign entities, but we are joined together as one united nations, okay? The 12 tribes were sovereign entities, but they were put together as a company of nations, as one nation, the nation of Israel. And we saw last time that that name was not only applied to Jacob, but his sons use it to apply to all of them as a group. First use of Israel as nation, speaking of nation. So God says, a company of nations. That's a unique statement, and it's referring to, we're not going to have separate nations now coming from you, Jacob. All 12 of your sons will each be sovereign nations, but in a sense, they're all together as one nation, a company of nations. So then God ascends, and the promise has been again reaffirmed but expanded, some new nuances that we see to this promise. Now we have the birth of Benjamin in starting in verse 16. So they journey from Bethel. They were at Bethel for a while, but then eventually they journey, and they were still some distance from Ephrath. That's just another name for Bethlehem, okay? Bethlehem, Ephrathah, you'll see the prophets speak of. So Ephrath, that's Bethlehem. And Rachel went into labor, and she had hard labor. And when her labor was at its hardest, the midwife said to her, "Do not be afraid, you have another son." And as her soul was departing, for she was dying, she called his name Ben-Oni, but his father called him Benjamin. Rachel, remember, was Jacob's favorite wife. He was the one she loved. He was the only one that he had made the deal to marry. And his father, Laban, had tricked him and given him Leah, and then he had to renegotiate, so then he got Rachel. And Rachel was the wife that was barren for years and years and years, but she prayed and prayed and prayed, and she even at one point, you know, spoke to her husband in anger and said, "Give me a son or I'll die." Remember her saying that? We talked about that. And God did answer her prayers, and she had Joseph. Now, many years later, she's still praying, and God gives her another son. But the tragic thing is that she dies giving birth to this son, kind of the reverse of what she had thought was going to happen. In a way, God was protecting her, but he did give her a son because, you know, God would use that son to fulfill the company of nations that he had promised, but it was a protection for her life. Jacob was able to, you know, have her with him for a lot longer than if she'd had, you know, those sons earlier, potentially. So, you know, this is later in her life, too, and giving birth is dangerous, especially at this time in Earth's history. It's a dangerous thing, and a lot of women died in childbirth, and this was hard labor, and it was while they were traveling. I'm sure they stopped when the labor started, but, you know, they'd been traveling, and that's stressful, and she's very pregnant, and so she gives birth, and the midwife comforts her, saying, "You have a son," because she'd prayed for a son, another son. So, you know, it is a comfort. God has answered my prayer. I've given my husband another son. That, you know, that was awesome. But she names her son Ben-Oni, which means son of my sorrow. Could also be translated son of my strength. Son of my strength. Either way. But I'm kind of thinking she meant it as son of my sorrow because she was going to have the sorrow of not getting to raise him, not getting to see him grow up. And that's tragic. But Jacob, grieving as well because Rachel is the wife he has loved forever, changed his son's name. He didn't want his son growing up with that kind of dark cloud of son of sorrow. Son of my sorrow. So he changes his name to Benjamin, which means son of the right hand. So he gives him an honor. You're the son of my right hand. And I was thinking about this. This is a son that Jacob is old. He's like 130 some. And he has Benjamin. And so in his old age, this is going to be the son of his right hand. It's like the son that's going to help him in his old age. That's kind of the idea there. And also honor him as his last son, his 12th son. He gives him a special honor as son of my right hand. His other sons are adults or very older teen adult kind of ages. So he has this new little baby son. Verse 19, so Rachel died, and she was buried on the way to Ephrath, that is Bethlehem. And Jacob set up a pillar over her tomb. So he sets up a memorial. It is the pillar of Rachel's tomb, which is there to this day. That's Moses' notation as he is writing the book of Genesis. So at the time of Moses, that pillar was still there. At the time of the prophet Jeremiah, he references it. They knew where it was, whether the pillar was still standing or not. They knew where it had been. And so Jeremiah references the Rachel's weeping and her, you know, her death and the spot where she died. And that was at the time of the Babylonian attack and they're being deported to Babylon. So for hundreds and hundreds of years, for centuries, many centuries, they knew that spot. Today, that spot is debated. There's a rabbinical tradition that it's just outside of Bethlehem, kind of between Jerusalem and Bethlehem. And if you go to Bethlehem, you pass right by it. There's like this monument that was built over the spot, not Jacob's stone, but a monument that was built. And you know, the rabbinical tradition says that's Jacob or Rachel's tomb. So the tradition is if you, like Rachel, are barren and you want children, you go and pray at Rachel's tomb. And the first time I went to Israel in 1988, our guide, this sweet little Jewish gal, she wasn't a believer, but, you know, we went to Bethlehem and we stopped by Rachel's tomb because she knew Mark and I didn't have children. And we wanted children, and we didn't have children. It was about 9 years into our marriage. And she said, I know the very thing. We're going to stop here at Rachel's tomb, and I want you to get out and pray for a child. Well, I'm not superstitious that it has to be that spot, but any time was a good time to pray for a child. So Mark and I got out, and we prayed there at Rachel's tomb. Within that year, we were pregnant, and we had Emily. No proof of anything, but it's just an interesting anecdote. So, yeah, there, Rachel's tomb. Actually, Rachel's tomb was actually near Ramah. Not near Bethlehem. It was on the way to Bethlehem from Bethel, and it was more likely near Ramah, which is what the Bible references it to be. And that is north of Jerusalem, still up in that high hill plateau kind of country, but not by Bethlehem. That's just a rabbinical tradition. But it worked for us. I don't know. Just a funny story. So going on, that's probably more detail than you needed to know. Now the sons of Jacob in verse 22 were 12. And so Moses here kind of wraps up Jacob's family. We've had Benjamin born, so now let's just recount because these are now the patriarchs of the 12 tribes. So we have the sons of Jacob and their mothers named. And in verse 27, it says, Jacob came to his father Isaac at Mamre, or Kiriath Arba, that is Hebron, three names for the same spot, which is south of Jerusalem, you know, not like terribly far, 20 miles maybe, on that same, you know, mountainous plateau hill country, just way farther south. And that's where Abraham had stayed and Isaac had lived there and Jacob now and all his family and everybody who's with him are there. And verse 28 says, now the days of Isaac were 180 years and Isaac breathed his last and he died and was gathered to his people, old and full of days, and his sons, Esau and Jacob, buried him. This is not actually in chronological order. It's just, like I said, this is the transitional chapter, so we're wrapping it up. So we're going to have the death of Isaac reported here. Isaac actually dies about 10 years later, but this is when it's put, because the next focus is going to be on Jacob's sons, and especially Joseph. So now everything at this point of his father's death, everything that had belonged to his father Isaac was now Jacob's. He's received the full inheritance, Isaac's property, the people that were with Isaac, all his servants and their families and grandchildren and great and great-greats. You know, by this point, you'd have several generations. They're all now under Jacob's leadership. And Jacob and Esau together bury their father. They take him to the cave of Machpelah, that little piece of property that Abraham had purchased. And Abraham was buried there, and his wife Sarah was buried there, and Isaac's wife Rebecca was buried there, and now Isaac is buried there. It's probably at this time that the family records are kind of put together, because the next chapter is going to record Esau and all his descendants. And Esau is an old guy by this point. So we have great and great-great grandchildren that will be mentioned in the next chapter. You won't go through that. I'll make the Sunday group endure that chapter. But Esau's descendants is the next one. That wraps it all up, and then the next chapter goes right into Jacob's sons and Joseph. But what we see here is Esau and Jacob, many years after Jacob has come back in the land, they are still on good terms with each other. So it was a true forgiveness. They have a complete reconciliation. I mean, it's just beautiful. It's all wrapped up. And their father was 180 when he died. Oh, I was saying this isn't chronological. It was about 10 more years at least. Jacob and all his company lived there with Isaac there in Hebron. And Isaac actually lived 12 more years after Jacob returns. And meaning Isaac is still alive when Joseph's brothers sell Joseph to the Midianite traders to be taken to Egypt. And Isaac is still alive at the point where Joseph is appointed by Pharaoh to be second in command. They didn't know that, what was happening with Joseph, because Isaac and Jacob both were told that Joseph had died. But God was working. Isaac didn't get to see that. But God was working while he was still alive, those last few years of his life. God was preparing a very special thing. And so next semester, we'll look at Joseph and his brothers. And the title of next semester is Never Forgotten. Never Forgotten. You are never forgotten, no matter what you go through, no matter who tries to forget you. God always has his eye on you. And you are never forgotten. You are never alone. So that's coming up next January. You'll have to come join us. We'll finish Genesis. God bless you.
Thanks for joining us online to watch one of our messages. I hope it was encouragement to you. Before you click off the tab and continue with your day, I want to invite you to partner with us with your financial blessing and offering and gifts to the Lord. You can find our giving button right above us on the upper right-hand side of the screen. We hope that we're able to continue to bless you in the future. God bless.